Thank you, sir. At the very onset, a word about Indian hospitality. The temperature in the room has been kept intentionally so low so as to make our European friends feel at home. Over the years, the missile technology has made rapid progress. Earlier generations of missiles could only be launched in tail aspect and had poor lock-on ranges. The missiles now have all aspect engagement, image and pattern recognition. The evolution of countermeasure technology has closely matched the advances in the field of aircraft and missile technology. The countermeasure dispensation system, CMDS, offers the last line of defense against incoming missiles. All the modern military aircrafts are now fitted with CMDS. Flares are used as a countermeasure against infrared homing missiles. Modern CMDS allows programming of different dispensation rates and patterns and have the capability to cue by other EWO sensors. The classical method of testing and operational training has numerous limitations. Thus, training and testing on usage of flares was one area which required an out-of-the-box thought process and implementation. In the next 20 minutes or so, I shall be covering the new test technique for flight evaluation of infrared flares. What you see on screen is one of the first pictures which we had developed in the process of evolving this new technique. It consists of four images. The first image is a raw image which has been captured of a Mirage just after landing. The second one is the processed image, where we have written the software for processing only the infrared part of it, computing the centroid. The third image which is there is a superimposed field of view, which is the red box which has been put, identifying the hottest region of the aircraft. And the fourth image is a true color representation of the aircraft along with the field of view which has been superimposed. I shall be covering my presentation under the following headings. Initially, I will be covering the evolution of missiles and flares. We shall see the broad generations of missiles and types of flares. I shall also be covering some of the important characteristics of flares. This will be followed by the flight and ground test procedures. I shall then cover the new test technique and the modeling and simulation approach adopted for this new technique. This will be followed by the advanced features which are modeled. I shall summarize the utility of this technique and the advantages accrued in this process before concluding. It shall be my endeavor to answer your questions thereafter. The IR missiles came into being in the early 60s. The IR missiles, over a period of time, have undergone a series of development. These are classified into the following generations. The first and second generations were missiles with detectors operating in the near IR band, which is the 2 to 3 micron, and did not have any cooling systems. The seekers were single-cell detectors, mainly using zinc sulfide or germanium. Due to limited number of detectors, the first generation missile had a very narrow field of view, typically around 30 degrees. This expanded to around 45 degrees in the second generation of missiles. Further, as there was no active cooling, the sensitivity of the detector was low, resulting in low lock-on ranges. First and second generation missiles were capable of locking on only in the tail aspect. Magic 1, early sidewinders are examples of this class of missiles. The third generation of missiles had all aspect capabilities and detector operated in the mid IR band, which is the 3 to 5 micron. The detectors, indium antimonide, were cooled with nitrogen. The detectors were arranged in a series which scanned the field of view. Magic 2 sidewinders, 9LM, are examples of air-to-air IR missiles, and SA-13 and 16 are examples of IR SAMs. The fourth generation of missiles incorporated advanced seeker technology like FLOCA planar array and incorporated more effective electronic countermeasures like dual color, dual band tracking, velocity rejection, rise time rejection, etc. The performance of these missiles were also better in terms of higher thrust and turn rates. The missiles had larger field of view and off-bore sight capabilities. Stinger and Mistral are examples of IR SAMs in this generation. The fifth generation of missiles had infrared imaging seekers. The missile head had an active array of elements through which the IR image of the scene is captured and tracked. The missile uses frequency and spatial discrimination to track the target. Flares could not be effective against this generation of missiles. The usage of directed infrared countermeasures would be the most effective countermeasure against this generation of missiles. AIM-9X, Python 5, IRST, MECA are all examples of this generation of missiles. CMDS is often the last line of defense against an incoming missile. There are two types of countermeasures against infrared missiles. These are flares and directed countermeasures. I shall be limiting my talk to flares. Let us now discuss some of the important characteristics of flares. Conventional flares are MTV flares. Magnesium is the fuel. Teflon is the oxidizing agent. And the Vitton is the binder. That's why it's abbreviated as MTV flares. Spectral flares are also available, which cater for the new generation of missiles, which does spatial discrimination, spectral discrimination. The flares produce an IR signature which is higher than the aircraft, thus offering a better target for the incoming missiles. The flares are dispensed through the CMDS. The CMDS can be programmed to dispense the flare. The programming basically decides the number of flares and the interval of dispensation. There are two types of flare dispensation that are, these are active and reactive. The reactive one is done when there is an indication of a missile launch. The other type of dispensation is a preemptive dispensation, which is done when a missile launch is imminent. The number of flares and the interval vary depend on the type of dispensation and the threat. Now, what you need to also understand is that there are two limits which are considered when you talk about the dispensation. One is called as the far limit and the other is the short limit. Now, short limit is that limit at which if the missile has reached the short limit, when you dispense a flare, the flare takes a finite amount of time, which is called as an ignition lag, to reach a particular intensity. So, in the short limit of the missile, the flare reaches that outside the field of view. So, it does not make or give any protection to the aircraft. The other limit is the long limit. The long limit is that distance at which the missile is. When the flare is dispensed, it has a finite burn time. Say approximately 5 seconds. So even after the flare burns out, the missile, the aircraft and the flare are both in the field of view of the missile. So actually it does not make a difference. So the dispensation has to be done when the missile is between the long limit and the short limit. I shall now give a brief overview of the ground and flight test procedure for evaluation of the flares. Some of the critical parameters of the flare are shown on the screen. The ejection velocity refers to the velocity at which the pellet is dispensed from the magazine. The radiant intensity is the intensity in the band of interest. The rise time is the time required for the flare to reach a minimum datum. And the burn time is the time for which the flare sustains the radiant intensity above a particular level. The ground test is carried out in lab, where the physical characteristics like dimension, weight, gas pressure buildup, etc. are assessed. The electrical properties of the squib, like resistance, no fire current, sure fire current, etc. are measured in the lab. The flare characteristics like ejection velocity, reaction force, ignition lag, radiant intensity, rise and burn time are all tested in the lab prior to the flight test. One of the key differences in the performance of the flare on ground and in the air is due to the wind velocity. It has been reported in open literature that the performance degradation is up to 10 times, as the radiant intensity would reduce by around 10 times when you conduct a ground test without any wind conditions and when you actually dispense up in the air. Flight testing of flares is carried out for the safe separation of the flare in the full envelope of the aircraft. The performance evaluation of the flare is then carried out. The flight test involves an airborne chase aircraft, which does a visual check on the separation. The dispensation is also filmed from onboard cameras. Airborne testing of IR countermeasures is done with training missile simulating lock before launch. The test methodology was to ensure that the missile has a lock on the aircraft and thereafter the flares are dispensed and the effect on the missile head is observed. The missile lock indication would continue even after the flare has burned out if the lock is retained on the aircraft. However, if the missile has shifted the lock to the flare, there would be a break lock when the flare burns out. This was also visually correlated with the moment of the missile hit. However, this test technique was subjective and dependent largely on the quality of training missiles. Thus, there was an urgent need to look for an alternate method for flight testing. I shall now describe the modeling and simulation part of the new test technique. In this process, the data was acquired from an IR pod and offline analysis was carried out using a software code written in MATLAB. The data was acquired with the IR pod being flown with the training missile to establish the correlation between the two. The IR image of the dispensation recorded in the pod was converted into frames. The frame was timestamped and numbered, and each frame was analyzed in the software. The frames were processed for normalization of the intensity for clutter, the user inputs on the field of view to be simulated, and the type of tracking algorithm to be used was sought before the process began. The centroid was computed inside the field of view and the coordinates passed to the next frame for processing. At the end of the process, all the frames were stitched back into a single AVF file. The process data was stored as a file for subsequent analysis. I shall now describe the test technique in brief. It's not very different from what we classically carry out, but it involves a modeling and simulation approach. The test entailed two aircrafts to fly different intercept profiles. One of the aircraft carried the IR pod and the other was fitted with the CMDS. The data from the aircraft, like the time, space, position information and the ranging information, was also recorded for analysis. The test entailed the aircraft carrying the pod to track the aircraft dispensing the flare manually in the center of the field of view. The flare dispensation was recorded in the pod and post-flight analysis was then carried out. I shall now describe the software process and show you as to what does the image actually look like. The software process can be defined in four stages. In the first stage, the raw data from the pod is loaded as single frames. What you see is a typical single frame. This is the raw data as recorded in the pod. You can see the silhouette of the aircraft in the center. This is the only part of the image in which we are interested in. The IR pod also works in the spectral band of 3 to 5. There is a lot of extra data which is in the frame which requires to be eliminated. These are all data which is not required and are superfluous to our test. So these have to be eliminated. The field of view and the sensitivity of the pod and the missiles are different, and hence there is a need to normalize. A threshold of each frame is detected and normalized. This is dependent on the background clutter. The field of view from the missile is superimposed and the processing done inside the field of view. The second part of the software process is now seen. The red box is the field of view of the missile which is being simulated. All the data which is above the particular threshold has been normalized, it is being reduced. The centroid is calculated inside the field of view and is marked with a star with an asterisk, which you can see right over here on the center of the image. This is the image as would be seen by the seeker. The centroid in terms of the XY coordinates are passed to the next frame for processing. Now, knowing the centroid position, the superimposed field of view is imposed on the raw data and you see as to where the actual aircraft is being tracked and where the field of view is. This is just a true color representation of a grayscale. The pod has got an 8-bit data for the intensity values. So you can actually map and see as to what is the temperature difference which is being shown. So what you see on the screen is a two color representation. Extreme hot is being shown in red and extreme cold, as would be the temperature in this auditorium, would be shown in blue. I'll just show you some of the files. This is the raw data which we have seen. This is the start of the track. Now, as I said, this is the aircraft which is flying a head-on to the aircraft carrying the pod. The pilot is tracking this manually, trying to put it at the center of the field of view. This goes into a loop. It's a small clip. So you see, this is the infrared image we are interested in. This is what we have to process and track. So this is the raw image which is coming out from the pod, and we are using this image or this file, superimposing our modeling and simulation and trying to assess what will be the effect of a flare being dispensed. The same set of images. You see the tracking algorithm is working fine when there is a jitter of the moment of the aircraft. The track window is always superimposed on the image. Due to the classified nature of the work which is being presented over here, there's been a lot of things which has been intentionally hidden. Otherwise, in this sequence of video, what would have happened is this aircraft would have continued, it would have dispensed a flare, and then we would have seen as to what is the correlation between the thermal image or the radiant intensity of the aircraft and compare it with the flare intensity. Now this next instance is where it has been moderated to a certain extent in order to declassify the information. But what you see over here is a flare being dispensed from the aircraft. So again you see the familiar four sets of frames. This is a raw image of the flare being dispensed, and you can see that the aircraft is actually behind the bloom caused by the flare. When you are doing a processing, you see only the flare intensity, so you can actually measure out what is the intensity of the flare, compare it to what is the intensity of the aircraft, and see as to how many times is it higher than the aircraft intensity. This is the superimposed data on the raw, and this is a true color representation. The centroid is still tracking, and the combined bloom due to the aircraft and flare. The aircraft is seen to be in the centroid, and only parts of the aircraft which are hotter than the rest of the aircraft is seen. The next instance of analysis chosen was when we are trying to model advanced features. The sensor being used to simulate a missile seeker is equivalent to an imaging infrared seeker. A software process was used to simulate the effect of electronic countermeasures. Two types of ECCM which has been modeled are the intensity rise time and the spatial discrimination. The aircraft IR intensity varies inversely proportional to the square of the distance. Thus, the intensity changes caused by the aircraft would change very gradually. However, the appearance of a flare in the field of view of the missile results in a sharp increase in the intensity and can be used to detect the presence of a flare. The rapid rise in intensity is used to flag the ECCM circuits. Another feature which is used to discriminate the flare from the aircraft is the rapid deceleration of the flare compared to the aircraft. When the flare is ejected out, it has a typical ejection velocity of 30 to 50 meters per second. However, this is used only for clearing the flare from the vicinity of the aircraft. Once in free stream, the flare decelerates and drops under the gravitational pull. This is used to discriminate the flare and the aircraft. A gated video tracker was developed, which would take the field of view of the missile to the leading edge of the image in the direction of motion. This results in the missile locking on to the leading portion of the image, which would be the aircraft when the flare separates out due to the deceleration. The algorithm used for modeling the ECCM is now shown on the screen. The average intensity of the field of view is tracked through the software along the direction of motion of the aircraft. The intensity in the field of view is checked with the previous values. If the rate of intensity changes beyond a particular threshold, an ECCM flag is set. When the flag is set, the software pushes the centroid to the leading edge of the image. This is done for 5 seconds, anticipating that the flare will burn out after 5 seconds. The centroid is computed in each of the frames. What you see now is the image with only the aircraft in the field of view without any flares being dispensed. I draw your attention to the centroid, which is an asterisk which is sitting right on top of the aircraft. And this is the image after a few seconds, after a few frames, when the flare launch has been detected. Once there is a rise in the rate of intensity, the leading edge of the image, which is over here, that is where the centroid is being positioned. Now, in the sequence of motion, because the software is keeping track of the direction of the aircraft, it is expected that when the flare is dispensed, it will decelerate while the aircraft will continue to accelerate. So, when I am tracking the leading edge, as the aircraft comes out from the bloom, it is going to catch the field of view and the field of view will continue to move along with the aircraft. The data produced by this set of simulation is now shown on the screen. The figure consists of three subplots. Subplot 1 on the top is the representation of the center of the field of view in the complete simulation. So you started off by having an XY. It started off from here. This is where the aircraft continued and this is where the centroid continued and finally moved on top. The motion of the field of view can be seen to start from the lower right and exiting from the top. The subplot 2 in the middle indicates the normalized intensity in each frame within the missile field of view. The x-axis indicates the frame number, whereas the y-axis indicates the normalized intensity in the field of view. Subplot 3 indicates where the algorithm has set the ECCM flag high based on the intensity ratio change. So two instances of dispensation were there and these have been caught by the software. And once this has been triggered, it keeps the gated video tracker cuts in and it moves the tracking into the leading edge so as to catch the aircraft when it comes out of the plume. Missile miss distance estimation is used to estimate the errors introduced in the tracking loop. This enables quantification of the errors in the same plane. The process is as follows. The software requires the aircraft to be marked in each frame and the software process tracks the centroid of the field of view. In each frame, the error between the aircraft and the centroid is computed and plotted, indicating the error buildup as a function of time. Now this is very critical because when you are operationally trying to assess the efficacy of the flare, it is always, the deployment of flare is always associated with a maneuver. So you have various test cases where you have two choices. You have to reduce your thermal signature, for which you will have to reduce the power setting of your engine, and you will have to do a maneuver so as to build up the maximum distance between the flare and the aircraft. Now there are two conditions, there are various possibilities of doing that. You can turn into the missile, you can turn away from the missile. All these things, when you are trying to quantify, it becomes very difficult in the earlier process of evaluation. So when you have something like this, you are able to now estimate as to what is the errors which is building up. Now what is being shown over here? The graph shows the estimated wingspan against the measured. What is expected is that the software expects the user to place the cursor to mark the wingtips and to estimate, this is used to estimate the size of the aircraft. As the some of the frames, the aircraft is masked by the plume, a linear estimate is taken so as to correlate what is the pixel size for each frame. The graph on the screen now shows the relative motion of the centroid and the aircraft. The aircraft was, what you are shown in red is where the aircraft was, and what is shown in blue is the position of the centroid. So you can see that the centroid is being pulled away from the aircraft. Now this particular error which is being built up is quantified and the error is shown over here. So now what this actually can be used for is for estimating how much is the error which has been accumulated, what is the maneuver which is to be carried out once a flare is being deployed. The utilization of the present technique is being done for comparative evaluation of flares, where the integrity of flare after dispensation is to be checked. The intensity and burn time is compared between the two types of flares. The trajectory analysis is also done using this particular technique. The assessment of dispenser location can be done using this technique so as to compare different dispenser locations on the aircraft. The technique can also be used to operationally train aircrew on the maneuver to be followed in different situations. There is a large scope for future work. Ground-based wide field of view thermal cameras mounted on tracking radars can be used to estimate the behavior of surface-to-air launched missiles. The fidelity of the simulations could be increased with after-launch performance. Airborne radiometric equipment with missile seeker heads would increase the accuracy of the simulation. Missile hardware-in-loop simulation with turntable and control inputs to drive turntables could be developed for assessing the effect of countermeasures. Flares provide self-protection to the aircraft against IR-guided weapons. The CMDS over the years have improved performance. Different types of flares are being tested on aircraft. Testing and operational training on usage of flares is currently undertaken using systems which are degraded performance and do not provide qualitative data. The software application developed using IR images captured from an IR pod and computing the moment of centroid on a superimposed missile field of view. The application tracks the centroid and outputs the image as an AVI file which can be viewed in any Windows media player. The software also incorporates ECCM features and provides a tool to quantify the errors introduced due to flare dispensation. The new test technique would enhance flight testing by providing quantifiable data on airborne performance of flare and could be used to fine-tune the operational training. With this, I have come to the end of my presentation. I shall answer the questions if there are any.
The software simulation analysis input is the video output.
That is right.
SVS. How accurate it is, the analysis?
See, the if you look at the different generation of missiles which is there.
Now, all the data, whatever is analyzed here,
yeah.
It is only video, in nothing else other than video.
It is the video image, it is an IR image which is recorded from the pod.
What is the sync for the basis, for the flight and timings?
It is the time sync which is there inside the
the video, whatever it is. Yeah. Is it accurate?
Yeah, it is accurate enough. We are doing around 30 frames per second. And within the simulation, that is good enough.
And one more, how do you see the timings, the burning times and holding time? You talked about that.
Yeah.
How you are analyzing using this video?
See, what is being shown is because the characteristics of a flare can't be talked about in an open seminar. That is why the talk has been restricted to showing you just one odd picture about that. Okay. But when you do the analysis, you see the entire trajectory of the flare. What you've been just shown is just one grab or one frame where you've just seen a flare and the aircraft is masked behind the flare.
Yeah,
so when you do the analysis or when you see the complete picture, you see actually the aircraft and you see the flare separating out. So
yes.
All the characteristics of the flare which you are otherwise measuring on ground, you can assess using this particular software.
That's why I got doubt. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. It is the radar ranging which is being used. See, there are two ways of doing it. Actually, when we did this, the pod itself can be manually queued. The pod can be manually queued to track the aircraft, or it can be queued along with the radar. So the radar actually queues the pod, and if you have a radar lock, you get the range from there, and you are able to get the timestamp data. So what we have been using is that we are using the range as what is given from the radar, and we are trying to see the pilot to keeping the aircraft in the center of the field of view. So the ranging information is basically from the radar in this case.
Thank you, Group Captain Nair,
sir,
for a very informative talk on this subject of IR flare testing.
Thanks.